بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وتم التسليم على أشرف الأنبياء سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد طب القلوب ودوائها ونور الأبصار وضيائها وعافية الأبدان وشفائها وبعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا خير خلق الله. This subject today that we will cover is regarding the unseen, which is al-jinn, the jinn kind, and practices which are performed particularly with the type of jinn known as shayateen, and that practice is known as asih, magic. And then the practitioners themselves, and then the cures relating to asih, magic. And remember, the attacks of shayateen are not limited to asih. Possession is of many types, and many people who suffer from possession of the jinn kind will know of this, that some possession is because of sihr and other types of possession are down to other reasons. But before delving into the subject, one must understand that apart from this universe, alam al-his, the tangible universe that we live in, there is a parallel universe which is alam al-jinn, in which the creation which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, known as jinn kind, exists. And regarding this, the ulama of Islam have written many works. One of the most detailed works is Adham Marjan fi Ajaibi wa Gharaibi Jaib. This work of Al-Imam Badruddin Abu Abdullah Umar ibn Abdullah Shibli Al-Hanafi rahmatullahi ta'ala. And he came in the 700s, and this book is very detailed. It covers all aspects of the jinn world. Al-Imam Jalaluddin Abdul Rahman al-Suyuti rahmatullahi ta'ala, who passed away in the year 911 in the Hijri calendar, he rahmatullahi ta'ala wrote a summarized version of this work known as Laqtul Marjan fi Ahkam al-Jan. And that summarized version has all the necessary important aspects of the jinn world. Shaykh al-Islam Ahmad Shihab al-Din ibn Hajar al-Haytimi al-Makki rahmatullah ta'ala has famous work Al-Fatawa al-Hadithiya. This is other than his four-volume Fatawa in the Shafi'i school. In this work, he answers many questions, and some of those questions relate to the jinn world and other subjects. For the most part, I have selected portions from this work because this work is concise, and the fatwa, the verdicts given by Al-Hafid Ibn Hajar Al-Haytimi rahmatullah ta'ala, are concise, and this would not bore the audience. On page 115, he has a matlab, muhimmun fil kalami ala al-jinni wa ahkamihim, an important speech regarding the jinn and the ahkam. Remember, the jinn kind are invisible beings, creatures that live parallel to us. And he states, Ja'a an Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhumah, أن الله تعالى لما خلق أبا الجان سموما من مارج من نار قال أن تمنى علي قال أتمنى أن نرى ولا نرى. He has reported from Sayyidina Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the father of jinnkind, like Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam is the father of mankind, jinnkind also have a forefather, and he names the forefather as being Samum. Others have said that the forefather is Al-Jan. The name of the forefather is Al-Jan. He created him min marijin min nar. And in the books like Akamul Marjan, Akamul Jan, they mention that the marij is the blue part that is visible in a fire. When you have a fire burning and there is sometimes a blue or a green part which is visible in the fire, this is known as marij, and from this mankind, the jinn kind were created. Now someone may say that even though they were created from fire, why do we not feel the fire? The reply to this would be that the way mankind, an insan, is created from teen, from soil, now our creation has evolved in the sense, not in the sense of evolution. Our creation has evolved in the sense when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam from mud and clay, later human beings became, and Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam was specifically flesh and blood. The essence which was mud is no longer existent in us physically. But our original creation was from mud. In the same way, the jinn kind, when they were created from this fire which is known as marij. But yet, their creation has changed and their bodies are invisible to us. With the exception of certain times when they become visible. Like when Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam was praying the night prayer, and a shaitan came to distract him. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam took hold of him, the jinn, and the spittle of the jinn was felt by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as cold. Now even though the spittle was cold, this does not negate the fact that the jinn kind have been created from fire. In the same way we feel heat from humankind sometimes, this heat does not negate that we were created from mud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the forefather of the jinn kind to wish for something. And he said, I wish for the fact that we can see, but we are not visible. وَأَنَّ غِيبَ فِي الثَّرَى وَيَسِيرُ كَهْلُ نَشَابًا فَأُعْتِيَ ذَلِكَ. He asked for a few more things. One of those things was that we can live under the depths of the earth. And this is why you will find that jinn kind, they live under the depths of the earth. Some of the cases of possession which have been brought to my notice, the person who is possessed will see the jinn kind living in caves and living underground when they are taken to those places in visions. And no jinn dies except that that jinn becomes young again. So they live very long, but when the time for them to die comes, they pass away and they have returned to their youth. Kahl. And they were given this. So Al-Imam Ibn Hajar states, فَهُمْ يَرَوْنَ وَلَا يُرَوْنَ. They can see, but they are not visible. وَإِذَا مَاتُوا غَيَّبُوا فِي الثَّرَى. And if they die, they go under the ground. This also happens when they are alive, because there are caves, which is mentioned that the jinn kind, when they came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose for the believers a region for them to live in, and chose for the disbelievers a region for them to live in. In Akam al-Marjan, fi Ahkam al-Jan, he mentions a dispute amongst the ulama that how many years prior to the creation of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam did the jinn kind live? And one of the sayings is 2000 years prior to Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, they were created. And there are other sayings also. And the jinn kind also heard the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam and heard Al-Quran al-Kareem. Some of them accepted Islam and others rejected Al-Islam. Now, Al-Qadi Abu Ya'la Al-Farra states, Al-Jinnu Ajsamun Mu'allafatun wa Ashkhasun Mumathalatun, that the jinn kind have bodies. They do have bodies, even though those bodies are not visible to us. وَيَجُوزُ كَوْنُهَا كَثِيفَةً وَرَقِيقَةً, it is possible for those bodies to become solid at times, and it is possible for those bodies to remain invisible. And most of the time they are invisible. This will tell us why the jinn kind, which is mentioned in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when a man sleeps at night and misses the Fajr prayer, the shaitan will sleep in his nose. Now, how can someone conceive of something sleeping in his nose? The reason is that the shaitan does not have a body like our body. It is more closer to something like electricity. The way we have electricity, which is a current, the jinn kind have a body which is latif, which is subtle. And therefore they can sleep in the nose of a person. And this is how they enter the bloodstream of a human being. And when they enter the bloodstream of a human being, there is a gap on the left-hand side of every human being in which the shaitan comes and places his snout. Because shaitan has a snout, as mentioned in the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ, when he places his snout into in that region, this is when he causes waswasa, whispering. And the only way of removing those whisperings is through the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we'll go on to that later. Then, he states further down that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, as narrated by Ibn Abi Ad-Dunya and Al-Hakim al-Tirmidhi and Abu Shaykh Ibn Mardawah, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خلق الله الجن ثلاثة أصناف صنف حياة وعقارب وخشاش الأرض وصنف كالريح في الهواء وصنف عليه الحساب والعقاب. This hadith has different versions. The majority versions are قال الجن ثلاثة أصناف فصنف لهم أجنحة يطيرون بها في الهواء وصنف حياة وَكِلَابٌ وَصِنْفٌ يَحُلُّونَ وَيَضْعَنُونَ, that the jinn kind are divided into three categories. A kind that has wings and flies. This type of jinn lives in the skies. And this, on the Laylatul Isra wal Mi'raj, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on the night journey, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw the skies covered with a creatures, and he asked Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam, what is this? And Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam said, this is the jinn kind that cover the skies from the eyes of mankind in order that they do not look at the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning the stars and the universe and the galaxies. This is a particular type of jinn that lives in the skies. And this explains many of the UFOs, unidentified flying objects which people see. Many of those unidentified flying objects may well be the jinn kind, the type of jinn that live in the skies. And this is one type. Then a second type which is mentioned is a type which is like snakes and dogs. This is the form that they take. This is why when the sahirin, the magician, perform their magic, one of the forms which the jinn will take in order to listen to the command of the magician is the form of dogs and sometimes the form of snakes. And a third type mention is the time upon which the hisab, meaning the resurrection and the judgment, will take place upon on the day of judgment. But this hadith, even though it mentions three types, this is not to say that they are not other types. This is why the general categorization of jinn cannot be limited to a few categories. And if you look at the books of like Qiyas al-Haywan and other books, they mention different categories of the jinn kind, and they take different forms. To the extent that some of the books of sihr, magic, even have numerous types of jinn, over 80 types of jinn, just categorized in the grimoires, the books, the manuals of magic, they have different types. And this is why when people see visions of fairies and different types of creatures, all those creatures will be categorized as jinn. Why? Because the word jinn in itself means to be invisible. Jannah al-jinn is to be invisible. This is why when someone becomes majnoon, why is he called majnoon? Because his intellect has become invisible, has disappeared. And in the same way, the fetus which is in the belly is called janin. Why is it called janin? Because the fetus is invisible. You cannot see the fetus. It is covered by the belly of the woman. In the same way, al-jannah is called paradise. Why? Because in paradise is invisible. Because these things are invisible, therefore the word is extracted from jannah. In the same way, jinn are creatures which are invisible, and there are many types which fall under the category of jinn type. Now, we know that every human being has qareen. Qareen is a jinn which, whenever any human being gives birth to a child, one child, the shayateen, they will give birth to 10 children. This is why 9/10 of the creatures are jinn kind. So there are more jinn than humankind. And this is something to take into consideration, because Ya'juj and Ma'juj are also humankind. And Ya'juj and Ma'juj multiply 10 times as fast as faster than the rest of mankind. And yet jinn kind multiply 9 times more than the rest of mankind. This is why some of the scholars thought that Ya'juj and Ma'juj are jinn kind themselves. But yet, because jinn kind are invisible, they have different tasks. And some of the hadith, like the hadith in Al-Tirmidhi, mentions that, for instance, there is a type of jinn which causes whisperings, waswasa, for wudu. When someone performs wudu, they may have whisperings of shaitan. The shaitan may cause whisperings for them that they have not performed wudu ablution correctly. And then they will consider themselves to have not performed wudu correctly and then go back. The ulama mentioned under this, and you can see this in Laqtul Marjan of Imam Suyuti, that the jinn that cause the waswasa of wudu are the first type of waswasa which will occur for a person. After this, the waswasa will get worse. And initially they start from the wudu. And the shaitan that causes the waswasa wudu is one of the worst type of shaitans. Remember, not all jinn kind are shayateen. In the same way, not all human beings are shayateen. Shayateen are a particular type of jinn and a particular type of ins, human beings. The word shatana is in the meaning of ba'uda, to move far away. Anyone who moves far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referred to as shaitan. And the one who orders humans and jinn believers to move away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referred to shaitan, also from jinn kind. And Imam Ahmad and Imam Muslim and At-Tirmidhi narrate from Sayyidina Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, أنه صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لم يسحب أحد ليلة الجن وإنما افتقدوه ذات ليلة فبات بالشر ليلة. That the night of the jinn, this is known as Laylatul Jinn. This is the night in which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam went out to meet the jinn and invite them to Al-Islam. The companions radiallahu anhu realized that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not present. And this was a bad night for them. Why? Because they did not know where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had gone to. فَلَمَّا أَصْبَحُوا فَإِذَا بِهِ وَيَجِيءُ مِنْ قِبَلِ الْحِرَاءِ. When the morning came, they found Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam coming from the direction of Hira. Hira is a cave which is in Jabal Nur and still exists today. فَذَكَرُوا لَهُ مَا كَانُ فِيهِ. They mentioned to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding the loss which they felt. فَقَالْ أَتَانِ دَاعِ الْجِنِ فَذَهَبْتُ مَعْهُ فَقَرَأْتُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقُرْآنِ. He said, the caller of the jinn kind came to me and I went to them reciting Qur'an to them. فَانْطَلَقَ بِنَا فَأَرَانَ آثَارًا وَآثَارَ نِيرَانِينَ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took us to where the jinn were and showed us the remnants of the jinn and where the fires of the jinn were. وَسَعَدُوا وَأَذَّارُ فَقَالَ لَكُمْ كُلُّ عَظْمٍ ذُكِرَ اسْمُ اللَّهِ تَعَالَ عَلَيْهِ وَكَانُوا مِنْ جِنِّ الْجَزِيرَةِ. That they said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the believing jinn, that what food shall we consume from? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them that every bone upon which the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been recited upon. So when someone consumes chicken or meat, beef or any other type of meat, halal meat, and recites the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying Bismillah and consumes that meat, in Alul Jinn, this becomes sustenance for the jinn. Now the bone itself, they mention this, like in Laqtul Marjan, some of the ulama state that the smell of that food and the moisture on the bone will become the food for the jinn. And once the smell disappears and the moisture disappears, that is when the food has disappeared for the jinn. This is why if someone leaves a pile of bones in a kitchen, this can attract jinn kind. This is why sometimes rubbish can attract jinn kind. If people leave heaps of rubbish outside, the jinn may be attracted, and not all the time, but this can be the case. And someone walking past can be affected by the jinn. And those particular type of jinns were the jinn of Jaziratul Arab, which are from the Arabian Peninsula. In the wording of Imam al-Tirmidhi, the hadith states, لَمْ يُذْكَرِ اسْمُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ يَقَعُ فِي أَيْدِيكُمْ أَوْ فَرْمَا يَكُونُ لَحْمًا وَكُلُّ بَعْرَةٍ عَنْفًا لِدَوَابِكُمْ. Which means that whatever the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not been mentioned, that will fall into your hands. So the wording is different. And it mentions that the dung of animals will be fodder for your animals. Now what does this show you? That the jinn kind have animals also, which are from the realm of the jinn world. In the way we have animals, the jinn kind also have animals. And those animals may sometimes affect human beings also. So the jinn is not, when we say the word jinn, it is not limited only to the shayateen, but also the word can be applied to the animals those animals consume from the dung of our animals. And that dung becomes fodder for them. This is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَلَا تَسْتَنْجُوا بِهِمَا فَإِنَّهُمَا فَعَانُ إِخْوَانِكُمَ الْجِنِ. That do not use bones and dung for istinja in the toilet. Why? Because this is food for the jinn to consume. Now here, Al-Imam Ibn Hajar al-Haytami rahmatullah ta'ala mentions, مَطْلَبٌ لَمْ يُبْعَثْ إِلَى الْجِنِّ نَبِيٌّ قَبْلَ نَبِيِّنَا قَطْعًا. He mentions the position that prior to our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no prophet was sent to the jinn kind prior to our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, this is an issue which is disputed. Because in Surah Al-Jinn, the jinn themselves are quoted as mentioning the scriptures of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. He has another mention here that Sayyidina Umar bin Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu, once buried a man from jinn kind. He states, أخرج البيهقي أن عمر بن عبد العزيز رأى حية ميتة وهو قاصد مكة حفر لها وكفنها في خرقة ودفنها. That Umar bin Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu saw a snake that was dead and he was intending to go Mecca al-Mukarramah. He dug a hole, shrouded the snake and buried it. فسمع قائلا يقول, he heard someone say, رحمك الله وأشهد لسمعتم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم تموت في فلات من الأرض فيدفنك خير أمتي. فقال له عمر, من أنت رحمك الله؟ قال, أنا رجل من الجن وهذا سرق ولم يبقى ممن بايع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من الجن غيري وغيره. He states that he heard a voice saying, Allah have mercy upon you, meaning Allah have mercy upon the jinn that had died. I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, you will die in a desert and no one will bury you except the best of my nation. Umar bin Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu said, who are you? May Allah have mercy upon you. He said, I am a man from the jinn. And this is Sarah. And no one who gave allegiance to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam remained except from the jinn, except me and him. And I bear witness that I heard the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that he will die in a desert and the best of my nation shall bury him. This shows us that sometimes the jinn kind will take a physical form, but for the most of the time, they are hidden. And here he has a chapter which is very important, which mentions, هَلْ تَجُوزُ مُنَاكَحَةُ الْجِنِّ أَمْ لَا. Is it possible to marry jinn kind or not? This is because some people marry jinn women, and some men from the jinn kind sometimes may molest a woman from mankind. This can happen. And he has a chapter on this. And he states that those ulama who said this is possible, they took this from the Quran. أَفَتَتَّخِذُونَهُ وَذُرِّيَّتَهُ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِنْ دُونِي وَهُمْ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌّ. In Surah Al-Kahf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, will you take him, the shaitan, and his offspring as friends or helpers other than me, and he is for you an enemy, the shaitan is an enemy. And another evidence which they use in Al-Quran Kareem is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in Surah Al-Rahman, لَمْ يَطْمِثْهُنَّ إِنْسٌ قَبْلَهُمْ وَلَا جَانٌ, which means no one had touch the women of paradise prior from mankind or jinn kind, showing that intercourse is possible between jinn and human beings. Now in Lafdul Marjan, Al-Imam Jalaluddin al-Suyuti rahimahullah ta'ala states that some of the ahnaf, the jurists of the Hanafi school, they said that if a woman has intercourse with a jinn, does she have to perform ghusl? And they said no. The Ahnaf, the jurists of the Ahnaf. The Shafi'is corrected them and said she must perform ghusl, because the same occurrence, what happens between a human being, happens with a jinn being also. But the Ahnaf say that this ruling falls under the ruling of someone having a dream. In the way if someone may see a dream and they do not see any nocturnal emission and they do not have to perform ghusl, in the same way if they do not see any nocturnal emission, then they do not have to perform ghusl. But this case is quite common, where women are raped by jinn or men are raped by jinn. And this is possible. And we will go on to this later as to why this takes place. He mentions here also that the most correct opinion is that amongst the jinn kind there is no prophet and no messenger from amongst them. This is the majority opinion, even though there's no ijma' on this. This is the majority opinion. He states, Dahar, one of the commentators of the Qur'an, held a divergent opinion. Another point which is very interesting, which he mentions, he states that أخرج أبو الشيخ عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن الملائكة كلهم في الجنة كلهم في الجنة والشياطين كلهم في النار والذين فيهما الإنس والجن. That the malaika, all of them, are in paradise and the shayateen will be in the hellfire. As for jinn and humankind, then depending on their actions, because they are mukallaf. And Al-Harith al-Muhasibi said, أَنَّا نَرَاهُمْ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَلَا يَرَوْنَا عَكْسَ الدُّنْيَا. That the way we see jinn kind, we do not see jinn kind on earth, we do not see jinn kind on earth. In the hereafter, in Jannah, in paradise, we will be able to see jinn kind and they will not be able to see us. It will be the other way around. Here, he mentions again on the authority of Sayyidina Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma, سُئِلَ أَيَمُوتُ الْجِنُّ. He was asked, do the jinn kind die? قَالَ نَعَمْ. Yes, other than Iblis. Iblis is the actual shaytan who did not perform sajda, prostration to Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. Apart from him, the rest of the jinn kind died. He will die prior to the day of judgment taking place. And he states that Ibn Shaheen said, أن الدهر يمر بإبليس فيهرم ثم يعود ابن ثلاثين. That time will go and Iblis will become so old, but then prior to dying he will become young again. Because this is what happens to the jinn kind. Now, like I've mentioned before, with every human being there is a qareen. When a human being is born, he is born with a qareen. And the qareen is a shaytan that orders him to do bad, evil. And Imam Muslim narrates that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha, مَعَ كُلِّ إِنسَانٍ شَيْطَانٌ وَمَلَكٌ. With every human being, there is a shaytan and an angel. قَالَتْ سَيْدَتُنَا عَائِشَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنَهَا said, أَوَ مَعَكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Is there with you, O Messenger of Allah? قَالَ نَعَمْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ أَعَانَنِي عَلَيْهِ حَتَّى أَسْلَمَ. Yes, there is, however, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped me against him and he accepted Islam. This is from the khasa'is, from the peculiar characteristics of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Otherwise, every human being has a shaytan with him at every time. And this is what is referred to as الَّذِي يُوَسْبِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ. The one who whispers in the chests of mankind. Now, these type of shayateen are two types. One is the shaytan that whispers from alam al-jinn, and the other one is from alam al-insan. So you will get a shaytan from insan, from humankind, that will whisper to you. And will whisper disbelief, or will whisper or tell you. But the way they will tell you is through the ear. The shaytan of jinn kind will whisper through the gap in the left hand side of the heart. Now this is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had khatam, the seal of prophethood, on the left hand side. Why on the left hand side? Because the left hand side stopped the shaytan from whispering. the khatam itself, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was protected from shaitan in all ways. And this is why the left hand side was chosen particularly. As for every other human being, the shaitan places his snout in that region because he is not physical like us. When he takes a physical form, that is something else. But otherwise, his body is invisible. And he places his snout, and then it mentions, Imam Suyuti mentions in Laqtul Marjan, that if the person does dhikrullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the shaitan moves back. But if the person does not do dhikrullah, the mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then the shaitan places his heart in his mouth and whispers. And then those whispers will be embedded in the heart. And this is what causes doubt in the head. In the heart and the head. And this sometimes may lead even to mental issues. Now, one interesting thing which is mentioned regarding the service, whispers of shaitan. وَجَاءَ عَنِ ابْنِ عَبَاسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمَا أَنَّ وَسْوَاسَ الرَّجُلِ يُخْبِرْ وَسْوَاسَ الرَّجُلِ فَمِنْ ثَمَّ يَفْشُ الْحَدِيثِ. That sometimes the qareen of one individual that gives him waswasa will inform the qareen of another individual and give him the waswasa of the other individual. And this took place with Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu had a thought and he did not reveal it to anyone. It was a waswasa. And a person informed Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu of this waswasa, and Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu said, as is mentioned, kharaja bihi al-khannas, that the one who has revealed this is al-khannas, the qareen. Now remember, those practitioners of sihr, people who practice sihr, black magic, they know how to control shayateen and qareen, the qareen of themselves. And this, some of them call this the muwakkal, and what they call muwakkalat. Some of them may state that the muwakkal that they call to, they control is an angel. But the sahireen, the sahara, people who perform magic, they control their own qareen because they perform certain practices by which they take control of their qareen. And then their qareen is ordered and tasked by them to carry out certain objectives for them. And one of those objectives is taking the wasawis of one individual and then informing them of those wasawis. Now some people may mix this up with kashf. Kashf, unveilings, which spiritual unveilings that people have. With regard to kashf, Al-Imam Abdul Wahhab al-Sha'rani rahimahullah ta'ala states that the kashf unveiling an individual may have, which will tell him the sins of another individual, is referred to as kashf shaitani, a satanic kashf. And if a pious person gets this, then it is a test for him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the same way, when a person who has control of his qareen, the hadith states, wukida ilayhi, that tawkeed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is done, the word wukida is used, from which the word muwakkal is taken, and a shaitan is given to him, which whispers to him, wasawis. But when they perform sihr, like magic, they take control of this qareen. And this qareen, then they will perform favors for the qareen, and the qareen will perform favors for them. And this is one of the methods which Al-Imam Ibn Hajar al-Haythami mentions, by which people, fortune tellers and others, can get information from others, and they may call this kashf, but in reality it is not kashf. Now, with regard to jinn, the jinn kind even have courts amongst themselves. They have courts. And Hafidh Ibn Hajar al-Haythami rahmahullah ta'ala mentions that Ibn Asakir mentions in his history أَنَّ رَجُلًا دَخَلَ بَعْدَ الْخَرَابِ لِيَبُولَ فِيهِ. A man entered an old building in order to urinate in that building. فَإِذَا أَيَّكُمْ فَقَتَلَهَا. He saw a snake and he killed the snake. فَمَا هُوَ إِلَّا أَن نُزِلَ بِهِ تَحْتَ الْأَرْضِ. As soon as he killed the snake, he was taken into the depths of the earth. فَاحْتَوْشَ بِهِ جَمَاعَةٌ فَقَالُوا هَذَا قَتَلَ فُلَانًا. He found a group of people saying, they weren't people, but they were jinn, saying that he killed such and such. فَقَالُوا نَقْتُلُهُ. And they said, we will kill him. فَقَالَ بَعْدُهُمْ اِمْضُ بِهِ إِلَى الشَّيْخِ. Take him to the shaykh. فَمَضَوْ بِهِ إِلَيْهِ فَإِذَا هُوَ شَيْخٌ حَسَمُ الْوَجْهِ كَبِيرُ لِحْيَةِ أَبْيَضُهَا. They took him to the shaykh. The shaykh was old, beautiful face and white beard. فَقَالَ مَا قِصَّتُكُمْ. The shaykh said to them, what is your story? فَأَخْبَرُوهُ. They informed him. فَقَالَ فِي أَيِّ سُورَةٍ ظَهَرَ. He said, which form did the jinn that he had killed taken? فَقَالَ فِي حَيَّةٍ. They said he took the form of a snake. فقال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول لنا ليلة الجن ومن تصور منكم في سورة غير سورته فقتل فلا شيء على قاتله خلوه فخلوني. That he said that the old man asked them, what form did this jinn take? And they said he took the form of a snake. And then he said, on the night of the jinn, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, whichever one of you being from jinn kind takes the form other than his own real form and is killed, then there is nothing upon his killer. And he said, khallu, let him go, fakhallawni, and they let me go. So this man, he had killed a jinn and he was taken to alamul jinn. And this is also mentioned that it is possible for a human being to be transported from this world into the world of the jinn. This is mentioned by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Shama'il of Imam al-Tirmidhi, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us the history of a man known as Khurafa. The word Khurafa means fabrications and tales. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do you know what Khurafa is? He said, Khurafa was a man who was taken by the jinn. And when he returned from the world of the jinn, he would inform people of what strange things he saw in the world of the jinn. And people would say, this is Khurafa. This is fabrications or tales. But the original name Khurafa is for an individual who was transported into the world of the jinn. So it is possible for an individual to be taken from this world to the world of the jinn. Now he has here an interesting part, which is it possible for someone to take hadith from the jinn or not? And he mentions the opinion of Ahlul Hadith, the scholars of hadith, that they state some of the ulama did not have an opinion on this, and some of them placed a condition that the jinn must be upright and meticulous, and others said that if he claims to be a companion, he must be upright. But the vast majority of Ahlul Hadith did not accept hadith from the jinn. Why? Because it is alul ghayb, the world of the unseen, and cannot be verified for everyone. These are some of the aspects of the world of the jinn which is mentioned. But remember simple things, like when entering a house and saying Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, before entering the house, this stops the accompanying jinns from entering the house. These are the simple things for protection. Whenever you enter the house, you say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Whenever eating, prior to eating, you say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, because the jinn partakes of the food. He eats with the left hand, his left hand, and he partakes of the food, and there is less barakah, blessings in the food. These are simple things which we are taught. These simple things are the things which protect people. Whenever you enter the house, say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, so the jinn do not enter the house with you and do not sleep in the house with you. Whenever you eat, say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, so they do not have any food from your house. Otherwise, if the jinn partake of your food and live in your house, they will affect your house. And they will cause disruption in your house. This is one of the main reasons that people have disruption, is because they do not have the simple practices of the sunnah, of the prophetic way. And from those simple practices, saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Prior to performing everything, saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Now, with regard to sihr, magic itself, because understanding jinn is one thing, but understanding sihr, magic, is another. Magic, or a sihr, is the use of shayateen to carry out the commands of the sahib, the magician. So from alam al-jinn, the world of jinn, we have particular type of jinn which are shayateen, who do not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and commit disbelief and cause havoc. Amongst them we have tribes. Those are the tribes which are employed to perform magic, sihr. And those who use jinn kind, shayateen from the jinn kind, are referred to as as-sahara, magicians. Remember, dividing magic into white magic and black magic is a misnomer. All magic is evil and haram and kufr, disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In order to understand magic, we have some of what the ulama mentioned, like Al-Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi rahmatullah ta'ala, who mentioned the types of magic in his tafsir of the Quran, Mafatih al-Ghayb. He states, Anwar al-Sihri thamaniyatun. Types of magic are 8 types. Types of magic are 8 types. He states, سحر الكلدانيين والكشدانين الذين كانوا يعبدون الكواكب السبعة المتحيرة وهي السيارة وكانوا يعتقدون أنها مدبرة العالم وأنها تأتي بالخير والشر وهم الذين بعث الله إليهم إبراهيم الخليل عليه الصلاة والسلام. One magic is the magic of the previous people, Al-Kaldaniyin, and another type of people, Al-Kashdaniyin. These are people who lived in Persia. And because they lived in Persia, we have the verse of Al-Quran al-Kareem which tells us, وَاتَّبَعُوا مَا تَتْلُوا الشَّيَاطِينُ عَلَى مُلْكِ سُلَيْمَانِ, that the magicians from the Jews and the Christians follow that which the shayateen recited in the kingdom of Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam. This is why if you had ever looked at a book of magic, which is haram, to read books of magic is haram, but they have books known as grimoires. Grimoires are books which were compiled in the medieval times in Latin, and now they have been translated into English. You will find that they attribute magic, as-sihr, to Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam. But Al-Quran Kareem states, وَمَا كَفَرَ سُلَيْمَانُ وَلَكِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ كَفَرُ, that Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam did not commit disbelief, but the shayateen committed disbelief. يُعَلِّمُونَ النَّاسَ السِّحْرَ, they would teach people magic. وَمَا أُنزِلَ عَلَى الْمَلَكَيْنِ بِبَابِلَ هَارُوتَ وَمَارُوتَ, and that which was revealed to the two angels in the area known as Babil, Babil is in modern day Iraq. And it is not too far from Kufa. These two angels were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach people the difference between al-mu'jiza, prophetic miracles, and magic itself. And when they would teach people, they would say, وَمَا يُعَلِّمَانِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ حَتَّى يَقُلْ لَا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ فِتْنَةٌ فَلَا تَكْفُرْ. They would teach people, but when they would teach people, they would say, we are a test, a trial, so do not disbelieve. But the reason why they would teach those people is so they could differentiate between miracles and magic. Because magic was so popular in the area known as Babil, that people were not able to distinguish between magic and miracles. So this first type of magic is the magic of those people of Persia. And they would worship the seven planets. Remember at that time, they would consider the sun a planet, they would consider the moon a planet. Planet Earth, and then Mars, Venus, Saturn and Jupiter. These were the planets that they would worship. And when they would worship these planets, they would believe the planets have a soul. And the soul of those planets is what is controlled and is what does the favors for them. So this was one type of magic. In reality, the souls of those planets were jinn-kind, were invisible spirits. He mentioned, سحر أصحاب الأوهام والنفوس القوية. This second type is very important. This type is more psychological. The magic of psychology. He categorized this as a type of magic. He states, أَنَّ الْوَهْمَ لَهُ تَأْثِيرٌ لَأَنَّ الْإِنسَانَ يُمْكِنُهُ أَنْ يَمْشِيَ عَلَى الْجِذْرِ الْمَوْضُوعِ عَلَى وَجْهِ الْأَرْضِ وَلَا يُمْكِنُهُ الْمَشْيُ عَلَيْهِ إِذَا كَانَ مَمْدُودًا عَلَى نَهْرٍ أَوْ نَحْرٍ. The mind plays tricks on people to such an extent that if they took a plank of wood and placed that plank of wood over the ground, not too high, but over the ground, they would be able to walk over the plank from one end to another. But if they took the same plank and placed it over a river or something dangerous, the same individual will not be able to walk that plank. Mastering this is psychological magic. When a person is able to do this, outwardly this may seem like magic. But there is something to be said regarding the categorization of Al-Imam Razi. Some of these types are not the haram type of magic, like this. This is not haram for someone to place a plank of wood over water and walk across it. And if he is able to do that over the ground also. But remember, the psychology of magic also plays a role in how people conceive magic today. And he mentions other examples. He states, أجمعت الأطباء على نهي المرعوف عن النظر إلى الأشياء الحمر. Another example is that the scholars of medicine prohibited a person with a continuous nosebleed at looking at red, because the mind will play tricks upon him. Because he is continuously bleeding through the nose, they say do not keep looking at red. And then he mentions, والمسرور إلى الأشياء القوية اللمعان أو الدوران. In the same way, someone who has epileptic fits, he is prohibited from looking at something bright or at looking at things which make him dizzy. Now, someone may use psychological magic on an individual and bewitch them, but this categorization would fall under misuse of psychology, and it would not fall under the category of using jinn kind. And this is why people need to differentiate between what is psychological and what is actual magic using jinn kind. Much of that which is prevalent is psychological. Why he states, وَمَا ذَاكَ إِلَّا لِأَنَّ النَّفْسَ خُلِقَتْ مُطِيعَةً لِلْأَوْهَامِ. This is only because the soul has been created to follow doubt. This is the second category. Then he mentions a third category. الْإِسْتِعَانَةُ بِالْأَرْوَاحِ الْأَرْضِيَةِ. Where people use arwah, remember, the word arwah, souls, is used for the jinn kind also. Sometimes, a person may die. Once he has died, his qareen may live on after him. His qareen may live on after him. His qareen may even take his form sometimes. And the people will think they've spoken to the dead. So when they perform seances, and many of the seances, cold reading is a psychological hoax. Cold reading is a psychological hoax. If people are sitting here and I say, I am seen in the world of the Arwah, the souls, and Abdullah, whose grandfather's name is Muhammad Abdullah, put your hand up if someone has a grandfather. Or Abdul Rahman. Now, someone's placed their hand up, Abdullah, Abdul Rahman. Two people have placed their hands up. Now when I say, I am reading an Abdul Rahman, and then I say, someone was worked in a factory, whose grandfather worked in a factory, your grandfather worked in a factory in Sheffield. Yes, he's nodding. So now am I going to claim that I know your grandfather is here from Alul Arwah? And if I say, his grandfather was in the army, was your grandfather in the army also? No. Was your grandfather in the army? Yes. His grandfather was in the army. Now this is chance. But it is psychological magic. This can be classified as magic, but psychological magic. But for this, a person is not killed, even though he's reprimanded by the ruler. And another way of doing this, the person, the individual said his grandfather was in the army, then I say he is complaining about his badges, the medals that he won in the army. Did your grandfather win medals in the army? Most people in the army, they had medals, simple medals. Now I will say, you forgot his medals, they are lost in Pakistan, you need to get those medals and polish those medals, etc., etc. This is how people play on the mind. The third type, which is using actual jinn, is the Arabi jinn, which is kufr, disbelief, where they call upon the jinn kind. And this is two types. The jinn are two types. One is believers, mu'minun, and one is kuffar, which are shayateen. The people perform sefer call upon the disbelievers. Remember, if believing jinns help a believer, this is permissible as long as the believer is not asking for their help and not enslaving those believing jinns. He is not enslaving them, because enslaving the jinn kind is haram. You cannot enslave them. So if jinn kind, and I would advise that he bell be removed from the masjid, this tahta kulli jarasin shaytan, under each bell there is a shaytan. This is why the scholars have mentioned the prohibition of bells. The scholars have mentioned the prohibition of bells. And the prohibition of bells is mentioned in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even though there are certain fiqh rulings relating to the bell, where certain scholars have allowed bell dispensation in certain situations. But this type of jinn, the third category, these people may use a certain type of bukhur, incense, which is burnt. When they use this incense, remember, incense, a type of perfume which is burnt, is ghada, food for the jinn. Now, atur, good perfume, is ghada, food for good jinn. This is why in the month of Ramadan, you should not burn bukhur during the day. Because the jinn are fasting, the good jinn which live in our homes. And you should burn the bukhur after Maghrib prayer, when they open their fast. Because for them this is consumption food. But the bad jinn, they like specific type of smells. This is why you will find that the bad jinn are attracted to bad smells. And this is why they live in the toilets. This is why Rasulullah ﷺ told us before going in to relieve ourselves to recite Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubuthi wal-khaba'ith. Why do they like those areas? Because the smell, the bad jinn, feed off the smell. And the people who perform magic may burn certain type of bukhur, but the type of bukhur they will burn will smell. It will not be the utur that we burn, the perfume, the fragrance. The fragrance, the good jinn, like, and this fragrance, the good jinn are not attracted to fragrance, this is a myth. Because it is from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But they are attracted to foul smell. Then, he mentions a fourth type of sihr. He states, التَّخَيُّلَاتُ وَالْأَخْذُ بِالْعُيُونِ وَالشَّعْبِذَا وَمَبْنَاهُ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ الْبَصْرَ قَدْ يُخْتِئُ وَيَشْتَغِلُ بِشَيْءٍ مُعَيَّنِ دُونَ غَيْرِهِ. This is trickery which is used in order to deceive the eyes. This is a fourth type. Now this, how do they do this? This some of you will know. If we imagine this to be a ta'weed, this is the ta'weed. Some of you will know this, especially those who accompany me. And what the practitioner will do, now, they'll have a ta'weed ready, prepared. The person comes to see them, and they will say, they will place the ta'weed here. Now they practice this regularly, so you will never notice. Yes? And they will talk to you. And then they will say, I am sending my muwakkal, to retrieve the ta'weed. And when they do this, they will call the muwakkal. So now look, nothing in my hand, nothing in the hand. And then, they will read an incantation, and then they will have the ta'weed. Now they will practice this very well. And when they have the ta'weed, they will say, the muwakkal has retrieved this from the grave of such and such relative of yours, and this relative done the magic on your family, and everyone has an auntie who they dislike, or an uncle they dislike, or a family rivalry, and then you will find scribblings on the, most of the time, uneligible. And then they will say that this is the magic which was done on your family. This is shahwada, this falls under this category. And another thing that falls under this category is that they will use certain chemicals, place them on your clothing, you will not notice, small powder, and then they will throw water on your clothing, and the chemical reaction will cause a fire and the clothing will burn. So you will think the person has placed water over my clothing and it is burning. Then you become peace up and give up. This is what happens. So, he Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi rahmatullah ta'ala states, he mentions, أَلَا تَرَى ذَا الشَّعْبِذَةِ الْحَاضِرِ يُظْهِرُ عَمَلَ شَيْءٍ يُظْهِرُ أَذْهَانَ النَّاظِرِينَ. Do you not see that the practitioner sometimes may make the onlookers so he will do certain trickery and he will make them neglectful. And he states, at the end he states, فَيَتَعَجَّبُونَ مِنْهُ جِدًّا. They will be surprised at him. Now the fifth type he mentions is al-amal al-ajibah allati tuzhiru min tarkibi the تظهر من تركيب آلات مركبة على النسب الهندسية كفارس على فرس في يده بوق كلما مضت ساعة من النهار ضرب اللوق من غير أن يمسه أحد. This fifth type is using technology. This fifth type is using technology. And look at how far ahead Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi rahimahullah ta'ala was. He said that they may make a figurine of a rider with technology that will come out with a torch or a thunderbolt. And in today's day and age, technology has been used to such an extent that they are able to make a figure of a human being on a stage who is not actually there. This would also count as sihr. Now, from this type, there are many types. Sixth type he mentions, al-isti'anatu bi khawath al-adwiyati, is using specific type of medicines. So, he mentions, يعني في الأطعمة والدهانات, foods or oils. Now, how this will happen, the person will give you a particular type of drink, and from the drink you will hallucinate. When you begin to hallucinate, they can hypnotize you. Hypnotism also sometimes involves hallucination. This is why when cults take people away, they will keep them hungry for days, and sometimes keep them sleepless for many days. So they will keep them without sleep, and sometimes they will keep them without food. Why? Because their mind will become more easy for them to be suggestible. People can suggest anything to them. If they are taken away from their home for a few days and kept hungry and kept without sleep, they are more suggestible. Satanic cults will do this. They will take college students away around bonfires and have a good time, and then they will be more suggestible to devil worship. Then, the seventh category which he mentioned, التعليق للقلب وهو أن يدعي الساحر أنه عرف الاسم الأعظم وأن الجن يطيعون وينقادون له في أكثر الأمور. إذا اتفق أن يكون ذلك السامع ضعيف العقل قليل التمييز اعتقد أنه حق. This person, what he does is he claims that he has al-ismu al-a'zam, the great name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or he will claim that the jinn kind all are obedient to him. When he claims this, he mentions that those who are weak-minded, they will follow him. Even though this may not be the actual case. وَتَعَلَّقَ قَلْبُهُ بِذَٰلِكَ. The only reason would be because of the attachment of his heart to this person. Because his heart will attach itself to this person, and this is what false Sufi sheikhs also do. False environment. How false environment? This is also psychological. If you enter a room, and prior to entering the room, you have a doorman at the door. The doorman says to you, take off your shoes before you see peace on, and make sure your clothes are clean, straighten your hat. Then you go into the door, and there's 20 people or 10 people around peace on, and peace on's dressed in his gown, and the lighting is even made in a specific way. This is all psychological. Peace may not even be able to recite Al-Quran Kareem. Peace may not even pray 5 times a day. But yet, the psychology has worked. That the environment has been formed in such a way that the person has gone in thinking this Peace must be someone with spiritual powers. Now, if Peace performs kashf on you, let me tell you a story. One of my students came from Rotherham with his brother, and he said that his wife will give birth to a child soon. What shall they name the child? I said they should name the child Juwayria. The brother exclaimed, next level. He said, what if the child is a boy? I said, Adam. He said, this is too much. I said, why? He said, my wife said, if the child is a girl, then we shall name her Jubayriyah. And if the child is a boy, we shall name him Adam. Now, this brother met me for the first time. He had heard that I had taught his brothers, and he saw me as an alim of the religion. And he had this image of me. Now, I could have taken advantage of this situation. But I waited. I waited for him to meet my other student. And I said to my student, how do you explain this event? My student, obviously having studied under me, said, this is probability. And that's what it was. It was probability. It was not kashf. Now, so if Peer Sahib meets you for the first time and he says, how is your business? Many Pakistanis are faking businesses. Everyone has a odd takeaway which is not running. So if he says your business is not doing so well and you feel that he has performed kashf, this is most of the time very psychological. And in the same way, if he says, how's your married life? Many people who have cousin marriages will not have fantastic marriages because of the disputes in the family. It's very common. Or anything depending. Remember, it's a myth. There's two myths revolving around bees. Number one, false bees. Number one, that all false bees are Pakistanis. This is a myth. It's a myth. The African brothers here will show you people in Africa who do this. The Arab brothers here will show you people in the Arab world who do this. And this is why Wahhabism is spreading. This is one of the main reasons why Wahhabism is spreading. Because of these false views. They have done a great favor for Wahhabi movement. Then, a second myth, that all peers are Bareilvis. No, in fact, you find the Deobandi peers, Shia peers, you find confused Bareilvi peers as well. They may attribute themselves to Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan, Rahmullah Ta'ala, but they have no link with Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan, Rahmullah Ta'ala. Those false peers that carry out false practices and are termed as Bareilvi have done the greatest disservice to Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan because they do not follow any of the fatawa, the verdicts of Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan. You will find the practices, the false practices these peers do, none of them will have a chain in their tariqah to Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahimahullah ta'ala. In fact, the best Sunnis of the subcontinent are the followers of Imam Ahmad Rida Khan, like Mufti Akhtar Rida Khan. To this day, no individual has shown me a video of a Mufti Akhtar Rida Khan tying jingles on his leg and dancing around graves. Or a Mufti Akhtar Rida Khan performing practices which they accuse Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahimahullah ta'ala of doing. Or the other ulama of Bareilly, like Diyal Mustafa. Why do not people, apart from the fact that they say videos are haram, so no one can get the videos, but they do not perform these type of practices. So why are these practices being attributed to Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan, rahimahullah ta'ala? Those people who are performing these practices have no link with Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan, rahimahullah ta'ala. And this should be made very clear. They only use the name of Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan, rahimahullah ta'ala, to attract followers. To attract followers. Then, the eighth method of magic which is mentioned is As-sa'yu bin namimati wa taqribi min wujuhin khafifatin lafqifatin wa dhalika shai'un fi al-nas. He states, carrying out namima and spreading this subtly. He's talking about psychological mind control. That which we know as psychological mind control is an eighth method which he has mentioned regarding magic. Psychological mind control. And this is very predominant amongst cults and amongst those who follow peers, false peers. I must be adamant that I am mentioning false peers. And if your peer is real, you got nothing to worry about. If your peer follows Sharia, you got nothing to worry about. I'm talking about false peers. People who claim to be peers, and they do not follow Sharia. Then, Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned, وَقَدْ أَدْخَلَ أَرَّاضِ كَثِيرٌ مِنْ هَذِي الْأَنْوَاعِ الْمَذْكُورَةِ فِي فَنِّ السِّحْرِ لِلَطَافَةِ مَدَارِكِهَا. That Al-Imam Razi placed most of these into a sihr magic because they are very subtle. These things are subtle. Now, psychological mind control is subtle. In the same way, people with weak hearts and weak mind, having mind control over them is something very subtle. Even though these do not fall under the category of magic that we are discussing, nevertheless this is employed today. For instance, there was a woman who had a problem with her back. So they took her to a false peer, and the false peer took out a pen. He took out a pen and a paper, and he said, he'd done this. And he said, is your back better? And she said, no. And then he done this. Is your back better? And she said, no. And he continued until the woman felt embarrassed. So she said, yes, my back is better. Or an example of where we have this individual in Birmingham. He places his hand around like this. And he says to people, do you have pains? And everyone, some people, remember, most of these settings are done with murid. So the people have given allegiance to this individual, and most of them do not understand what it is to be a murid of a sheikh. We will go on to that truth according to Imam Ahmad Khan rahimahullah ta'ala in his work. But because they become murid, they comply. So, they will say, who has a pain in their back or in their, any part of their body? And then a few people will place their hand. And then he will say, place your right hand on the pain. And those people will place the right hand on the pain. Then he will say, I am giving the faith, the very blessings. And then he will attribute this to his ancestor, who may have been a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But remember, most of the being a son of a wali does not make you a wali. Being son of a scholar does not make you a scholar. And then he will do this. And then he will say, whose back is better? And then the murid will place their hand on. Many of you will know of in psychology what they call conformity. Conformity or group conformity is when you have a group of people doing one thing, the person who is overwhelmed by the group will carry out that thing also. Sometimes the group may be good and sometimes the group may be bad. And psychological research has shown when there is a group of people carrying out bad and there is one individual who is overwhelmed by them, he will join in also. So these type of methods, Imam Fakhruddin Razi rahimahullah ta'ala covered these already. And remember, the books of magic, for instance, there are researchers to sihr magic, like Abdul Fattah al-Tuhi. He has many works written in Arabic on magic, the methods of magic. And there are many grimoires which were written in the medieval ages where people wrote manuals. There is no need for anyone to read these works. The ulama have mentioned that it is prohibited for an individual to read these works. Unfortunately, people who are interested in this subject will read many works on this subject, but they will not have time to read the works of the ulama on this subject. Or Al-Quran Kareem. People find it difficult to recite one juz of the Quran daily, but if you give them a book on magic, they will read it cover to cover. If you give them a book of Aleister Crowley or the Bible, Satan's Bible and these other books, they will read it cover to cover. But you give them a copy of the Quran, a copy of the books of Hadith, they find it very difficult to read. Even though the works of Hadith have covered, the Quran and the Hadith have covered this subject completely. Now, the methods employed by the magicians with regard to bringing an actual jinn, the methods used are many methods. One method is Tariqat al-Iqsam, where the sahir will perform incantations And those incantations may sometimes be from the language of the jinn. So sometimes those incantations are not eligible or not understandable. And because the person cannot understand them, they do not know what they are reading. So they may say, Ya, and they'll say an odd name. And they do not know what those names are. Now sometimes those people, they will place verses of the Quran or hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-ad'iyya al-ma'thura, prayers from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in between the prayers, they will place odd formulas. Now someone may say, how can they do this? The reason why this is done is this is done to ihana the Quran, to disrespect the Quran. So they place the Quran, then they will place a line which does not make any sense in Arabic or any other language. But it will be from the language of the jinn or from a language which is lost now. And then they will place another verse of the Quran. All of this is prohibited. And even the Christians, if you look at the works of some of the Christian Freemasons, you will find that even they have the Lord's Prayer or the Christian prayers, and they will place, within the prayer, they will place satanic incantations within the prayer. So this has been carried out by people claiming to be Muslim and also by those who are non-Muslim. With regard to this, also the magicians will make talismans. Now, how do we distinguish between ta'widat? Ta'widat are talismans which are used by the ulama. And how do we distinguish between those talismans and the talismans of the magicians? We will go on to this shortly, but you should know that the talismans are one of the ways by which the magician will use to control a jinn. Because sigils are specific type of forms which are written by the magician. They will make a figure, and when they will make that figure, the jinn will be attracted to that figure, the diagram. There are particular type of diagrams which are used by magicians, and jinn are drawn to those diagrams. Sometimes the jinn will be enslaved by the diagram. Now, those sigils are even used by corporations sometimes. The corporations will use a sigil, and when they use a sigil, a diagram, they will cover the sigil by making it look like something else. But the diagram itself is still embedded in the logo. This is why logos of cloth companies, logos which are manufactured by many companies throughout the West and the Eastern world, you will find that some of those logos have a satanic origin. The reason why that is done is because they believe that those logos have an effect, as what they would call a spiritual effect, to make people buy their products. This is known as sigil magic. Then, other methods which are used are methods of slaughtering. They will make blood sacrifices for the jinn. Now sometimes, after the blood sacrifice, this may vary. Sometimes the sacrifice may be a chicken. Sometimes if the ego of the shaitan is bigger, the animal will get bigger. So a cow or a goat. And in extreme cases, slaughtering children or slaughtering humans, adults. Now, particular type of sahi magicians, they have methods of determining those kids which are suitable for slaughter. What they do is they look at the hand lines of the palm of the child, and if the lines are straight diagonally, this indicates something regarding the blood of that child. In fact, the blood of that child may be used in alchemy. Now, if anyone wants references for this stuff, they can ask me at the end. I can reference all of this, but this is something which is mentioned in the books, that they look for straight lines. Why? Because the blood of the child is considered to carry properties for alchemy, which they will use. And alchemy is not only to turn metal into gold, alchemy is different types. The sihr of alchemy is various types. So, also why they spoke to children is for the energy which the children have. Now we heard recently of the pedophiles, not only the taxi driver pedophiles you had here up north, I don't think they were involved in black magic, but they were involved in some satanic practice nevertheless. And we also heard of the pedophiles in the institutions of this government, people all the way from 10 Downing Street. And we heard of the case of some BBC star who was also, has been related now, and it's not conspiracy theory, that he was involved in satanic practices also. These are rituals which these people carry out in order to please Shaitan. We do not need to go into more gory detail because people will get scared and some people may even have nightmares regarding these issues. But the point, the key to understand is that these people are pleasing Shaitan. Whatever pleases Shaitan, what is the key to understanding what pleases Shaitan? Whatever goes against Al-Quran, whatever goes against the Sunnah of the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, can be conceivable for those who worship Shaitan. Then, another method which is employed is something which is very common amongst Peels and some Mulbis also. It's a very common practice and we must be very careful of it. This practice is known as Hazli. In the subcontinent community, it is a practice which is known as Hazli. The Birmingham Mulbis, some of them, are very prominent in this practice. And this is something we should warn people of. And anyone who is doing this practice, you cannot pray behind it. Because he's involving himself with jinn. What they do is they ask for a child to be brought. And you must be very careful of this. They blindfold the child. When they blindfold the child, they recite something. And then the child sees a vision. When the child sees a vision, he is told that Baba Fulan, and sometimes the actual names of major awliya, like Shaykh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani radiallahu anhu, or Asif Barkhiya radiallahu anhu, or in extreme cases, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. And in some cases, even Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, they are told that that child is witnessing those awliya. And then the child is asked that wali regarding lost property or things which have been lost or have been stolen or regarding divorces or regarding anything relating to those issues. Then the child gives the answer. This practice is known as Hazri. And this practice is impermissible. Another impermissible practice is where they recite certain things and the cloth may grow large or small. But now I have to mention something. There are some scholars who use only the Quran to do this. This practice of the cloth growing large or small. There are some scholars who only use Al-Quran al-Kareem. That method is valid. Wherever there is only Al-Quran al-Kareem being employed, that method is totally valid. But the practice of Hazri, of placing the blindfold on the child, is impermissible. Firstly, this individual is claiming to call the souls of the awliya. And in some cases, to call the souls of the Sahaba al-Kiram, the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who is this individual to call Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu and ask him? In extreme cases, they ask, who stole 500 pounds from my safe? Can you imagine this? Someone claiming to call Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu or to call a Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask him regarding these things. Firstly, who is this Peer to call the souls of these major awliya and major companions and the anbiya alayhi salatu wa salam. Who does he think he is? Secondly, when they recite, they never tell you what they are reciting. If they are only reciting Quran or prayers which are valid, then they will recite this out loud. They have nothing to hide. And thirdly, why are they only calling children to perform this practice upon? In some cases, the children will have an after effect. Their heads may hurt because the person, the peer, has carried out this practice, their heads will start hurting and they will have headaches. And in some cases, the child is attacked by jinn because, in fact, they are using jinn, what they call muwakkalat. These muwakkalat are jinn and nothing else. And if they are claiming that they are using angels, takhsir al-malaika, that they are using angels, then we would want to know what they are reciting in order to call those angels. What are they reciting? Because this is a practice which they are claiming, and they must prove that this practice is from Al-Quran or from the Sunnah or from the ulama of Islam, from the scholars of Islam. Now, Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar Al-Haytami rahimahullah ta'ala, again in Al-Fatawa Al-Hadithiyah, has many interesting verdicts relating to these practices. With regarding to Ilmul Awfaq, Ilmul Awfaq is the science of Ta'widat. When people use numbers, how do we differentiate between those ta'widat which people use for numbers and those ta'widat which people use figures? And remember, the Sahara, people who perform magic, also use numbers. And therefore people become confused between the two. Firstly, anyone who writes out a ta'weed, when he writes out the ta'weed and he binds the ta'weed and tells you not to open the ta'weed, this is a practice which is false. Who has told them not to open the ta'weed? Is there something mahzoor being prohibited in the ta'weed that we cannot open the ta'weed? In fact, you should be allowed to open the ta'weed. There is nothing wrong with opening up a ta'weed. This is not prohibited. And the other practice which they do is that they use names which are uneligible. You cannot make out what those names are and who those names belong to. Now, Al-Hafir Ibn Hajar Al-Haytami rahimahullah ta'ala mentions Ilmul Awfaq. Ilmul Awfaq is the knowledge relating to numbers. They ask him, Ma hukmu Ilmul Awfaq? What is the ruling relating to Ilmul Awfaq? He states, بِأَنَّ عِلْمَ الْأَوْفَاقِ يَرْجِعُ إِلَى مُنَاسَبَاتِ الْأَعْدَادِ وَجَعْلِهَا عَلَى شَكْلٍ مَخْصُوصٍ. The science of awfaq returns back to numbers and the appropriability of numbers and placing the numbers in a specific table, in a specific way. وَهَذَا كَأَنْ يَكُونَ بِشَكْلٍ مِنْ تِسْعِ بَيُوتٍ. This will be done, for instance, that they will write at 9 squares. مَبْلَغُ الْعَدَدِ مِنْ كُلِّ جِهَةٍ خَمْسَةَ عَشَرًا. The sum of each number from each direction would be 15. This is an example. So for instance, if someone drew a square, there's another square, and the square had 3 boxes in a row, then each box would have a number, and if you count the boxes in any direction, they will reach the same number. So for instance, 15. So if you have 3, 4 and 8, that makes 15 in that direction. And in this direction, 3, 5 and 7, which also makes 15. and then in the other direction, in any direction, it will make the same number. He states, وَهُوَ يَنْفَعُ لِلْحَوَائِجِ وَإِخْرَاجِ الْمَسْجُونِ. This is sometimes beneficial for needs and taking people out of jail. وَوَضْعِ الْجَنِينِ. It also helps in a woman giving child. وَكُلُّ مَا هُوَ مِنْ هَذَا الْمَعْنَى. And many other things, meaning it is something which is a part of medicine. وَضَابِتُهُ. وَكَانَ الْأَغْزَالِ رَحْمَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى يَعْتَنِي بِهِ كَثِيرًا. This science Imam Ghazali rahmatullah ta'ala would use. Hatta nusiba ilayhi, to the extent that this science was attributed to Imam Ghazali. Wala mahdura fihi, there is nothing wrong with it. In istu'mila li mubahin, if it is used for mubah, meaning acts which are not prohibited. Bi khilafi ma idha istu'ina bihi ala haramin, as opposed to it if it is used for haram prohibited acts. وعليه يحمل جعل القرافي الأوفاق من السحر. This is the interpretation of Al-Qarafi, where he said that Awfaq is magic. So there was a group of ulama who said the usage of numbers in such a way is magic. And there was a group of ulama who would use this, like Al-Imam Ghazali, rahmatullah ta'ala. Al-Imam Ibn Hajar al-Haytami states that the group of ulama that used this, used it like anything else in medicine. For instance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in a tablet, a paracetamol tablet, the power to remove a headache. If someone uses this with the belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed that in the tablet, then it is fine. In the same way, ilmul awfaq, which is used in this manner, is permissible. But those ulama who said it is magic, we're referring to awfaq when it is used in the impermissible manner, like al-qarafi. Now, further down, and remember, those questions which are vague will be clarified. He mentions, again, he is asked, مَا حُكْمُ عِلْمِ الْأَوْفَاقِ. What is the ruling of ilm al-awfaq? He states, ilm al-awfaq la mahdura fihi in istu'mila limubahin. The science of awfaq is number conjugation and used in medicine. There is nothing wrong with it if it is used for mubah, meaning practices which are not haram. فَقَدْ نُقِلَ عَنِ الْغَزَالِ وَغَيْرِهِ الْاِعْتِنَاءُ بِهِ. It has been copied from Imam Ghazali that he would use this science. وَكَذَلِكَ حُكِيَ لِي عَنْ شَيْخِنَا شَيْخِ الْإِسْلَامِ زَكَرِيَ الْأَنْصَارِ. It has also been related to us regarding our teacher, Zakariya al-Ansari rahimahullah ta'ala. أَنَّهُ كَانَ يُحْسِنُ وَأَنَّ لَهُ فِيهِ مُؤَلَّفًا نَفِيسًا. That he would practice this and he wrote a whole book on the subject. أَمَّا إِذَا اسْتُعِينَ بِهِ عَلَى حَرَامٍ فَإِنَّهُ يَكُونُ حَرَامًا. If however, if it is used for haram, for prohibited acts, then it becomes haram prohibited also. Now, further down, he mentions ilmul awfaq again. Now all of you know the science, which particular science I'm referring to. The ta'weed which you receive, which has boxes and numbers in there. He mentions, he is asked, مَا حُكْمُ كَتْبِ الْعَزَائِمِ وَتَعْلِيقِهَا. What is the ruling on writing عَزَائِمِ? عَزَائِم is referring to the ilm al-awfaq, making boxes with numbers in there which have a curing property and wearing them. He states, يَجُوزُ كَتْبُ الْعَزَائِمِ الَّتِي لَيْسَ فِيهَا شَيْءٌ مِنَ الْأَسْمَاءِ الَّتِي لَا يُعْرَفُ مَعْنَاهَا. It is permissible. It is permissible if the thing which is written, there is nothing in there which does not have something which is uneligible. So this now makes the matter even more clear. That if you receive a ta'weed which contains a name you cannot even read, and some of these false beings will even write the ta'weed in such a way you cannot read it, then you should not take such a ta'weed. If it has names which you cannot distinguish, you should not take such a ta'wil. And he states, وَكَذَلِكَ يَجُوزُ تَعْدِيقُهَا عَلَى الْآدَمِيِّينَ وَالدَّوَّابِ. It is permissible to place this upon human beings if it has numbers which are eligible and names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which are eligible, which are very clear. And remember, if someone goes into the toilet with a ta'wil, he must fold it and place it in a leather case. Now, with regard to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, which mentions prohibition of ta'wizat, the ulama like Jalaluddin Suyuti rahmatullah ta'ala and Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Haytami rahmatullah ta'ala mention that this is referring to those azalim, those ta'wizat, those talismans which contain shirk, polytheism, and this would also apply to those talismans the meaning of which is not known. Now, further down, Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Haytami rahmatullah ta'ala mentioned, they asked him, عن كتابة الأسماء التي لا يعرف معناها. What is the ruling on writing names which the meaning is unknown? What is the ruling on this? وَتَوَسُّلُ بِهَا. And using these as a means, هَلْ ذَلِكَ مَكْرُوهٌ أَوْ حَرَامٌ. Is it makruh, disliked, or is it prohibited? وَهَلْ هُوَ مَكْرُوهٌ فِي كِتَابَةِ وَتَوَسُّلِ بِتِلْكَ الْأَسْمَاءِ الَّتِي لَا يُعَرَفُ مَعْنَاهَا أَوْ حَرَامٌ فِي التَّوَسُّلِ دُونَ الْكِتَابَةِ. Is the dislike in writing these names or using them as a means in those names the meaning of which is unknown, is it impermissible just in tawassul or writing them down? فَقَدْ نُقِلَ عَنِ الْغَزَّالِ. Because Imam al-Ghazali, Abu Hamid al-Ghazali rahmatullah ta'ala, it has been reported from him, أَنَّهُ لَا يَحِلُّ لِشَخْصٍ. It is not permissible for an individual, أَنْ يُقْدِمَ عَلَى أَمْرٍ, to go into something, حَتَّى يَعْلَمَ حُكْمُ اللَّهِ فِيهِ, until he knows the ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding that thing. Meaning you cannot do something until you know the ruling from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهَلْ فَرْقٌ فِي ذَلِكَ بَيْنَ مَا يُوجَدُ فِي كُتُبِ الصَّالِحِينَ كَعَبْدِ اللَّهِ بْنِ أَسْعَدْ الْيَافِعِي وَغَيْرِهِ أَمْ لَا. They ask him, if this is found in the books of the pious scholars, then is there a different ruling for this? Now this is very important, this subject. Firstly, he has clarified for us that if a person writes a talisman with numbers, and that those numbers have a healing property, this is known as ilmul awfaq. And this is permissible in the way medicine is permissible. And it has been mentioned that if a person believes that ta'weed in itself cures, then he has committed shirk. No one believes that ta'weed in itself cures. They believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed aqaqir. Aqaqir is medicines. There are medicines on earth which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed healing properties in. This is how ilm al-awfaq is treated. And the prohibition of azaim from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in some hadith is very explicit, that it is relating to those ta'wizat which have shirk. Now he is being asked regarding those ta'wizat which have names that cannot be understood. He replies, الَّذِي أَفْتَى بِهِ الْعِزُّ بْنُ عَبْدِ السَّلَامِ كَمَا ذَكَرْتُهُ عَنْهُ فِي شَرْحِ الْعُبَابِ أَنَّ كُتُبَ الْحُرُوفِ الْمَجْهُولَةِ لِلْأَمْرَاضِ لَا يَجُوزُ الْإِسْتِغْقَارُ بِهَا. العز بن عبد السلام, سلطان العلماء, mentions, as is mentioned by the author in his book شَرْحِ الْعُبَابِ, that those books which have letters which cannot be understood and the meaning of which is not known cannot be used for ruqya. Cannot be used for ruqya. Ruqya is when we recite Al-Quran Kareem and load this upon an individual. This is the prohibited ruqya, the prohibited healing. And he states, وَلَا أَرُقَى بِهَا, and neither can this be used for talismans. لِأَنَّهُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ لَمَّا سُئِلَ عَنِ الرُّقَى, when the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was asked regarding talismans, قَالَ اِعْرِضُوا عَلَيَّ رُقَاكُمْ فَعَرَضُوهَا فَقَالَ لَا بَأْسَ. In one hadith, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, present to me your talismans. Or, more specifically, what you recite over the people. And he looked at it and said, La Baksa, there is nothing wrong with this. Because those particular ruqya, ruqya meaning what you recite over the ill patient who has a jinn or an issue, that particular ruqya did not have any shirk in it. وَإِنَّمَا لَمْ يَأْمُرْ بِذَٰلِكَ لِأَنَّ مِنَ الرُّقَى مَا يَكُونُ كُفْرًا. Because sometimes from the ruqa, there is those types of ruqa which are kufr, disbelief. وَإِذَا حَرْمَ كُتُبُهَا كَتْبُهَا حَرْمَ أَتَوَصُلُ بِهَا. If it's prohibited to write such ruqa, then it is prohibited to use the names as well. Now if someone uses these names, like they use names, different names, you must ask them the meaning of that name. And where have they taken that meaning from? If they cannot establish the meaning of that name, then you should never use that name. Now they have many names. Some of them sound like a third language, a language which is unheard of. Now if someone uses that name in incantation, when they use that name, using that name and blowing it on an individual, or they write down that name, you must ask them, where did you take this name from? And they must refer it back to either a valid language which they have knowledge of, or back to the books of the ulama. And he will mention what the ruling is when it's referred back to the books of the ulama. He states, Na'am, yes, in وَجَدْنَا فِي كِتَابٍ مَنْ يُوَثَّقُ بِهِ عِلْمًا وَدِينًا. However, if we find this in a book which is trustworthy, and trustworthy in the knowledge and the religion of the person, فَإِنْ أَمَرَ بِكِتَابَتِهَا وَقِرَاءَتِهَا احتمل القول بجوازه حينئذٍ. If the author ordered people to write it or recite it, then it is permissible for people to do so. So if you find this in a work of a scholar, like many of the valid practitioners will refer this back to a valid scholar like Imam Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala, then he states it is permissible in such a case. لأن أمره بذلك الظاهر أنه لم يصدر منه إلا بعد إحاطته وإطلاعه. Because his order for doing so did not emanate except after he had deep knowledge regarding this subject and upon its meaning. وَأَنَّهُ لَا مَحْذُورَ فِي ذَلِكَ, and there is nothing prohibited in this. وَإِنْ ذَكَرَهَا عَلَى سَبِيلِ الْحِكَايَةِ عَنِ الْغَيْبِ الَّذِي لَيْسَ هُوَ كَذَلِكَ. However, if the author just related this from someone else, but did not do tahqiq, research on the issue, then it is not permissible. So, even when the person gives the ruling relating to the ta'wid, the writing of a specific name, he must have done research on that name. And the person who has done research must be reliable. Otherwise, it is not permissible. أَوْ ذَكَرَهَا وَلَمْ يَأْمُرْ بِقِرَاءَتِهَا. Sometimes the author may mention it, but he does not order the reader to recite it, because he may just be mentioning it. وَلَا تَعَرَّضَ لِمَعْنَاهَا. Or sometimes he did not mention the meaning of the name. If he does not mention the meaning of the name, then it is also impermissible. فَالَّذِي يَتَّجِهُ بَلْقَاءُ تَحْرِيمِ بِالْحَالِ. In such a case, then it still remains impermissible. وَمُجَرَّدُ ذِكْرِ إِمَامٍ لَهَا لَا يَقْتَدِي أَنَّهُ عَرَفَ مَعْنَاهَا. By the scholar, only mentioning its name does not mean that it is permissible.
And he mentions regarding the book of Imam al-Yafi'i, he states, وَلِذَٰلِكَ تَجِدُ فِي وِرْدِ الْإِمَامِ الْيَافِعِ أَشْيَاءَ كَثِيرَةً لَهَا مَنَافِعُ وَخَوَاتٍ. You will find in the book of Imam al-Yafi'i many things, they have benefits. لَا يَجِدُ مُسْتَعْمِلُهَا مِنْهَا شَيْئًا. But sometimes, وَإِن تَزَكَّتَ أَعْمَالُ وَصَفَتْ سَرِيرَةُ. Sometimes a person may use the particular thing and nothing will happen. So even when we find names within a book, it does not mean it is permissible for us to use the names without understanding what those names are. And if the author does not mention the meaning of those names, it still remains impermissible. The only type which is permissible is if the author mentions the names and then mentions the meanings of those names and mentions the benefits from using those names. And it must be taken from a reliable source. Now, Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar Al-Haytami rahmatullah ta'ala has something interesting to mention regarding magicians. As-sihr. Remember, many of the magic cases that we have, people always suspect a relative of having performed the magic. And when they go to these amideen, they known as amideen, they will say, such and such relative has carried out this action. But remember, no one has the knowledge of the unseen, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals his knowledge of the unseen to a Nabi, like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these false peers do not have access to that knowledge, to the knowledge of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And those awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who have kashf will never reveal to you the relative, because this will cause family feuds. So this is the sign of a false peer also, that he will tell you who the relative is. Sometimes they may mention, I can see a man with a dark face. Now most of us are Pakistanis, we love the odd relative with a dark face. Or I can see a light-skinned man. And again, Pakistanis have light-skinned people as well. Or a light-skinned woman, or a dark-skinned woman, or a tall man, or a short man, and then someone will think of his relative, maybe his uncle or auntie, and then he will begin to think that they have done magic on him. So this is something, another trick which the trickster uses. Now, they ask him, is it permissible? Hal min as-sihri ما يفعله أهل الحلق الذين في الطرقات ولهم فيها أشياء غريبة كقطع رأس الإنسان وإعادتها ونداء له بعد قطعها وقبل إعادتها فيجيبون. He mentions that sometimes magicians sit on the road and they may sever the head of an individual, cut the head off of an individual, and then talk to him. And then, after they cut the head off, they may join the head on again. Is this permissible for us to sit down and watch such people? Or sometimes, وَجَعْلُ نَعْوِ الدَّرَاهِمَ مِنَ الْقُرَابِ. Sometimes they will take out coins from the soil. Sometimes, this is trickery. Most of the time, it is trickery. For instance, one magician placed in a coffee cup, at the bottom, a sponge, and underneath the coffee cup, a hole. And then on top of the sponge, a cover. Then he placed coins at the bottom of the cup. Because the coffee cups are big. So at the bottom he placed a sponge, then on top of the sponge he placed a cover, Then on top of the cover he placed coins. Then he filled the coffee cup with hot coffee. And at the bottom there is a hole. Now the coffee does not seep out because it is covered from the top of the sponge. Then he offered this coffee to a gypsy on the road, hot coffee, and he said, "Let me take this coffee from you for a minute." And he shook the coffee, and the coffee disappeared and coins appeared. How did he do that? He placed his finger under the contraption at the bottom, the hole, lifted the sponge, broke the cover, the sponge absorbed all the coffee, and he pushed the contraption to the top halfway. So the coins came to the top and the coffee fell to the bottom. And the sponge absorbed the coffee. Now it seemed to the onlooker that the man is making coins appear. So these are many tricks which tricksters use today, which have been uncovered by other tricksters also. So Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar رحمه الله تعالى is asked وغير ذلك مما هو مشهور عنهم وكذا كتابة المحبة والقبول. Sometimes these people will use talismans of love. Like for instance, some of them mention that if you take 3 peacock feathers and you do something with them, I will not tell you the full formula, people will love you. Or they mention sesame seeds, how to use sesame seeds. And you use sesame seeds, place one in your hat and one in another place, and then people will love you. So he's asked regarding this. وَإِخْرَاجُ الْجَانِ وَنَحْدُ ذَلِكَ. And sometimes these tricksters on the road, they will bring out jinn out of people. Is this permissible or not? هَوْلَاهِ فِي مَعْنَ السَّحْرَةِ إِنْ لَمْ يَكُمُ السَّحْرَةً. He states they will be considered magicians even though they are not actually performing magic. This is trickery. So, in the types of magic which Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi rahmatullah ta'ala mentioned, these kind of practitioners also fall under magic. فَلَا يَجُوزُ لَهُمْ هَذِهِ الْأَفْعَالِ. It is not permissible for them to do this. This is impermissible. Now, the punishment in Sharia, the legal law, is death, capital punishment for the magician. But there is a difference of opinion on these tricksters. That capital punishment applies to people who perform a sihr, magic, which involves jinn. So this fatwa is long, but the conclusion of the fatwa is that it is impermissible for us to even watch them, because you are encouraging them. That this happens if you go to Marrakesh, you have the square where they perform these tricks. And even in England, in London, if you go to certain areas, they will perform these tricks. It is impermissible for a Muslim to watch such things. Now, here he mentions a question regarding usage of jinn. Is a person allowed to use jinn and enslave them? He states, what some women do is they will use sihr practices in order to make their husband love them. Sometimes the husband may do this. For instance, the husband may wash his feet, and then they make the woman drink the water. But they do other things as well in that practice, which I will not tell people. There may be an odd shaitan who hears this and then carry this practice out. But this is impermissible in Sharia. In the same way, there are practices like the woman uses the blood of her menses in a certain way. This is haram in Sharia. Or sometimes they write certain talismans and they place the talisman on an animal, on a rabbit. And the rabbit will run, and then the woman will run away from home. Or in some cases, they will use blood in specific ways. One bead, false bead, I have to qualify the word false bead. Use chicken blood to write the Tawiz. Now anyone with basic knowledge of Sharia will know that chicken blood is najasa, impurity. You cannot write ta'weez with impurity, and you cannot use impurity to cure yourself. In the same way, if a man suffers from impotence, they will place a ta'weez on his leg or below his belly button. This is impermissible because you are placing this around the aura. And some of them even may use Quran. They will write Quran and place the Quran, وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ, refuges with Allah's sword, around those regions. In the same way, some magicians, they will rip the Quran, or they will place the Quran on their feet. One magician, who throughout his life people thought was a pious person, when he died, they found he had placed masahif, volumes of the Quran, under the toilet. And when he was alive, he would perform pseudo miracles in front of people. These are sahara, magicians. And he is asked, are these type of practices allowed? He states, والصواب, the correct opinion, أن التقرب إلى الروحانية وخدمة ملوك الجان, that gaining proximity to spirit or using the kings of the jinn for service, من السحر, is from with magic. وهو الذي أضل الحاكم العبيد لعنه الله حتى ادعى الألوهية. He states, this is something which misguided a ruler in his time, or be prior to him, until this ruler began to claim that he was God. He used sihr. And as Imam Ahmad al-Tahan rahmatullah ta'ala mentioned in Al-Fatawa al-Tawiyya, that those who use tahdeer al-jan is making jinn present and using those jinn for their services, the hallmark will be that many of them will have takabbur, arrogance. This is why you will find these false people walking around as if they are Fir'aun on earth. They will have their murids around them, and the murids in some cases will kiss their feet and kiss their hands, even though kissing their hands is permissible. I'm saying this is something when you make ijbaran, forceful, making, if 20 murids of a peer are surrounding you and each one is kissing the hand and you come along and you shake hands, they will all look at you to make you feel guilty, even though you have not done haram. It is not haram if you meet a scholar, you just shake his hand. It is not necessary to kiss his hand. But this is psychological pressure. So this takabbur, arrogance, because many of them dabble in tahdeer al-jan, in making the jinn present. And this makes them very arrogant with people. So some of them will do odd practices. So he states this is all impermissible. Then, وَسُئِلَ أَيْضًا عَمَّنْ يَكْتُبُ كِتَابَ عَطْفٍ لِمْرَأَةٍ أَعْرَضَ عَنْهَا زَوْجُهَا لِيُقْبِلَ عَلَيْهَا. He's asked regarding a person who writes a love potion for a woman who her husband has left her. وَيَكْتَفِي شَرًّا, and this وَتَكْتَفِي شَرًّا, and this will protect her from his evil. فَأَجَابَ, now this is very important, he replies, أَمَّا بَيْنَ زَوْجَيْنِ فَأَرْجُ أَنْ يَكُونَ حَقِيقًا يَكْتُبُ بِكَتْفِ الْقُرْآنِ وَغَيْرِهِ مِمَّا لَا يَسْتَنْكِرُ مما لا يستنكر ولا يشترط في جعله. قلت وهذا خلاف ما تقدم له, الا ان يقال ان هذا برقى ظاهره الحسن كرقي ابي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه سيد الحي الملدوقي الفاتحه. He mentions the only type which is permissible is that type which is written with Al-Quran al-Kareem. Now what happened with Sayyidina Abu Sa'id al-Khudri رضي الله عنه was that a leader of a disbelieving tribe was stung by a scorpion. When he was stung by the scorpion, Sayyidina Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu recited Surah Al-Fatiha over him. This is permissible. And in the same way, It is related regarding Abdullah bin Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anh, that he would write Al-Qur'an Kareem and place it around the necks of his children. If Al-Qur'an is used for these practices, then it is permissible. Otherwise, it is impermissible. Then, he is asked again regarding those ta'aweed upon which those things are written which are not eligible and cannot be understood. And he mentions, and we covered this in detail already, I'll give you the summary of it. He mentions, وَمَذْهَبُنَا فِي ذَلِكَ أَنَّ كُلَّ عَزِيمَةٍ مَقْرُوَةٍ أَوْ مَكْتُوبَةٍ, that every talisman which can be recited or written, إِنْ كَانَ فِيهَا إِسْمٌ لَا يُعْرَفُ مَعْنَاهُ, if it, in there is a name which is not understand, it is not eligible. فَهِيَ مُحَرَّمَةُ الْكِتَابَ, it is prohibited to write it. وَالْقِرَاءَ, and to recite it. سَوَاهُمْ فِي ذَلِكَ الْمَسْرُوعُ وَغَيْرِهِ, whether it is for a person possessed by a jinn or whether it is for anything else. But he mentioned, وَإِنْ كَانَتِ الْعَزِيمَةُ أَوِي الرُّقْيَةُ مُشْتَمِلَةٌ عَلَىٰ أَسْمَاءِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَىٰ, however, if the talisman or the ruqya which you are reciting has the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَآيَاتِهِ, and the verses of Al-Qur'an, وَالْإِقْسَامِ بِهِ وَبِأَنْبِيَاءِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ جَازَتْ قِرَاءَتُهَا عَلَىٰ الْمَسْرُورِ وَغَيْرِهِ, if it has verses of Al-Qur'an al-Kareem, or names of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wa salam, or names of the angels, then it is permissible to recite upon the one possessed by the jinn. And we covered this previously, that if the name is not understood, then if it is taken from a reliable source, then the source must explain what the meaning of that name is. And if they do not explain, then it is impermissible to use. Now, with regard to jinn possession and psychological problems, many of the jinn people who are possessed with jinn, many of the cases are women. And sometimes the woman may be suffering from postnatal depression or pressure from the in-laws in many cases. And this makes the woman go mad, or lack of satisfaction from her husband. This sometimes leads for a woman to act and behave in a way as if she has jinn. In one case, there was a woman who was a divorcee, and she was a divorcee and she claimed that she was possessed by a jinn. But someone who had analyzed the case made it obvious to the family that the woman is distressed and wants to get married again. Because unfortunately in our communities, divorcee women find it very difficult to get married again. This is a very bad habit of our people, that they do not marry divorcees. So she was trying to express the need to get married again, and she done this by pretending to be possessed by a jinn. In some cases, the young girl does not want to marry the choice of her parents, so she may pretend that she has a jinn, then they may take her to a peer. And sometimes these peers may, false peers and Sufi sheikhs, because the peer, some people connect this only with Pakistanis, but this happens in other communities also. The false Sufi sheikh may even abuse the young woman in some cases by touching them. When it is impermissible for any peer to touch his muridat, his student, it is impermissible. Remember, they mention in the Hanafi fiqh books that a young man may shake hands with an old woman, but the other way around it is not permissible. An old man with a young woman, because the old man is different to an old woman, and the young man will not have desire for an old woman, a really old woman. When they say old woman, they mean a woman who is really old. And it is impermissible for an old peer also to touch the heads of his muridat, his students, or to allow them to kiss his hands. This is impermissible in Sharia. And if such a peer does this, then he has broken Sharia. And then In the same way, some of those practitioners may make the woman do certain practices, and this comes out in certain cases where the woman may claim afterwards that the bee may have touched her in an inappropriate way. These type of things should be reported to the police. Any type of paedophiles that we have in the masajid must be reported to the police straight away, and should be placed on a sex offenders register and should be kicked out of our masajid. This is a very important issue, because Islam has no room for paedophiles. We are not like the Catholic Church or like the Jews that were reported recently in some documentary someone was telling me, where any case of child abuse that takes place, they cover the case of child abuse. No. Any sexual offenders should be reported to the police. And the same with these false Sufi sheikhs who carry out sexual offenses to the victims. Now, so psychological issues and medical issues also. For instance, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah mentions in his book on tibb, medicine, that an imbalance in the body can sometimes cause problems in the mind. Too much bile, for instance. If someone has too much black bile, that will cause waswasa. Sometimes waswasa is psychological. And this can be remedied. It can be remedied, for instance, by going out to a hot country, gain some vitamin D, having sun on the head and the brain. It can be remedied in other ways. Psychiatrists sometimes mention waswasa in their terminology. Remember, waswasa is three types. One is waswasa whisperings, which deal with thoughts of disbelief, kufr, or bid'ah, innovation. Second type of waswasa is thoughts of a sexual nature, which are impermissible, things which are impermissible. Our sexual nature, which you will never say. These are waswasa. Something which you will never say or do. The third type are violent type of waswasa. Violent waswasa, which a person would never say or do. The psychiatrists mention that if a person has these type of thoughts, look, they give the same advice as the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam orders the believer to stop thinking of those things and not to reflect on them. This is why if someone lives on their own in a house, they can suffer from waswasa, because they will not have the company of people. They are left to their own mind, and they will reflect on the waswas, the satanic whisperings or the whisperings of the mind. And when they do this, the problem can become compounded. It can get worse, and they may need psychological help. It starts from wudu, ablution, but it can end up in more severe problems. So, the way of ridding oneself of waswasa sometimes is medicinal. Like he mentions in Ibn Qayyim, that if bile overcomes the mind, then the bile will cause waswasa as well. So too much lentils, if someone eats too much lentils, dal, this can cause overwhelming bile, black bile in the brain. And when there is too much bile in the brain, this can cause waswasa as well. In the same way, the psychological waswasa, they mentioned that if you place an elastic band on the wrist, whenever you gain a waswasa, pull the elastic band to remind yourself to stop thinking. And after a while, when you stop thinking about those things, after a while the waswas will stop. This can last a week. You practice this for a week, you pull the elastic band, people around you will not know what you are doing. You will have an elastic band, you will just press the elastic band, they will not know what you are doing. But the waswas will stop. Because you will remind your mind, you will train your mind to not to reflect on the waswas. In the same way, al-mu'awwidhatayn, reciting Surah Al-Falaq and Surah Al-Nas on a regular basis, rid oneself of waswas. you recite Surah Al-Falaq and Surah Al-Nas and Surah Al-Ikhlas. قُلْ وَاللَّهُ أَحَدْ قُلْ أَعُوذْ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقْ and Surah Al-Nas قُلْ أَعُوذْ بِرَبِّ النَّاسْ. You recite each surah three times with Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim after the Fajr prayer, the morning prayer, and after Al-Maghrib prayer. If you do these each chapter three times, inshallah, after 3 days, your wasawas will stop. This is the spiritual cure. And then there is the medical cure. Remember, some drug addicts, people who smoke cannabis, and the cannabis which is dealt with in Al-Abraq and other areas of Birmingham is not pure cannabis. It is laced with other chemicals. This, when a person will come off cannabis, the mind will play tricks on them. In the same way, alcoholics, former alcoholics, when they come off alcohol, their mind will play tricks and they will think it is waswasa. Then they will go to the false peer. They will go to the false peer. Their parents will take them to the false peer, and the false peer will not look at the background of the youngster and look at the fact that he has just come off alcohol or he has just come off drugs and his mind is playing tricks. This person needs to go and take medication. The doctors will give them, the GP will give them a subscription of tablets. They take those tablets for about a month and the wasawas will stop. The whisperings will stop. But unfortunately, our people never admit to psychological problems. So they may take the person to a peer. Now these peers have been known to perform practices which are false. For instance, one case, a man went to London. He took his friend to London and the peer ordered them to give money for sacrifices, the biha, and sacrifices for goats. So they gave £100 and he said, now I will sacrifice this for the muakkalat. Now we talked about these muakkalat, what they actually are. In some cases they may not even exist. Sometimes it is psychological. For instance, you get a child, you place a blindfold around him and you say, you are seeing a meydan. They say meydan meaning an empty piece of land. And the child will think this. And then they will say, people are coming, and then the child will think this. Sometimes it is psychological. Other cases, it is actual sihr. Now, what they done is that the false peer ordered them to get pots and fill the pots up with lentils, dal, and then place nails in the lentils. And then he ordered them to go to a graveyard and dig up holes and place those pots in the graveyard. They did this many times until they gave that individual over £15,000, I think. Over time, the money accumulated into £15,000. Now, our people have a problem. They seem to think anyone who does not take money is real. This is not the case. You do not judge by the fact only if they take money or not. You must also look into the fact as to whether the practices this man is telling me to do, are they in accordance with Sharia? This is the second thing. If they are not in accordance with Sharia, it does not mean if he does not take money, because many of them do not take money because it is better sometimes to have the cow rather than milking him once or twice. What do I mean by this? If you come to me, and I milk you, I take money from you, you will not become my murid, my student, and go away. But it is better to gain your trust first by giving you a free service, and then you will belong to me when you give me allegiance, altar of allegiance, and then you are my murid. Now I own the cow and I can milk it many times. This is why some of them do not charge. And some of them do not charge, so they gain the reputation that Peer Fulani, Peer such and such does not charge, then people will go to it. But they will have a box and say, place in the box whatever you want for my madrasa. Oh, and they never have madaris because these people are never into Quran or Sunnah or into ulum.
I do not know what they teach in their madaris. But nevertheless, these are type of practices which they tell the person to do. Another practice, for instance, they will tell the person to go to the sea and get seawater, and no one must touch this seawater. One person done this, he went to the sea, he got the bowl, placed it in the boot, they said not one drop must drop a full out of the pot. So from all the way from the sea, he came all the way to central England, making sure the car does not bump or shake and no drop comes out. Yet his brother had been on cannabis and had psychological issues. So many of these issues must be checked, verified first. You must check if your child is just basically not willing to marry his cousin in Pakistan or her cousin in Pakistan. You must check if they are unhappy with their marriage. You must check, is it postnatal depression for the girl who has just given, a woman who has given birth? You must check, is your former alcoholic, has my child been drinking? You must check, is he under some kind of mind control of some cult, some weird cult? Because we have many false Sufi cults now as well in our midst that make people do odd practices, weird practices, which are not from Islam and are not from Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah, which the Najdiya Wahhabi movement use against Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Has my child been brainwashed that this is causing psychological problems for him? And in the same way, we have problems with ulama. Is he under some psychological mind control of a local imam? This happens also. So you must check all these pros and cons. Is he under some psychological mind control in college or university? Are the teachers in college or university playing tricks on his mind? Are children in the schools or in the college or university dabbling in the Ouija board? These kind of things must be checked. Are they dabbling with drugs and alcohol? After all of this has been checked, then a person can determine as to whether the problem is actual sihr, magic, or is actual jinn. These things must be verified first. Now, one of the ways of determining whether the person has a sihr, a magic on them, done on them, is by reciting certain ruqya on them. And the ruqya is mentioned in the books from Al-Quran al-Kareem, Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar al-Haytami, Rahmullah ta'ala, has a whole work on this issue. The same author of Al-Fatawa al-Hadithiya, which is named here as Dhikr al-Athar al-Warida fi al-Azkar allati tahrisu qa'idaha min kayd al-jinn. Those hadith which have been mentioned, that if a person recites what is contained in those hadith, it will protect that person from jinn. Now, when the jinn attack a person, sometimes the jinn can simply be in love with that individual. This is not sihr. Or that person may have caused harm to that jinn, and the jinn wants to take revenge on that individual. So the practitioner, remember, like in the science of medicine, and like in the science of psychiatry, and like in the ulum sharia, legal sciences, jinn extraction is a profession. A profession in the sense that only experts should do it. This is why I'm leaving out a lot of detail how they carry it out. The only things I've mentioned for you are guidelines for distinguishing between a true practitioner and a false practitioner. And I will summarize those guidelines toward the end again. But the practitioner will recite, and now I'm just explaining as by way of summary what the practitioner does. He will recite Quran over that person. There are different ways of doing this. And we have done this in the past. Some of the brothers have recordings of some of the jinn extractions, but we do not release the
these recordings because of the patient, for the protection of the patient. It's not good to place these videos online, like many of the Najdiya do this. They place their videos online and taking jinn out. But this should not be done because of the victim. Anyhow, the Quran is recited over the individual. When the Quran is recited, there is a point at that time which I will not tell the victim, that if he is possessed by jinn, then the jinn will speak. In some cases, what the victim will do is fall asleep. Initially, he will start yawning and then he will fall asleep. Now, I will not tell the individual when he is supposed to fall asleep. If he falls asleep at the wrong time, he is not possessed. He is acting. In the same way, there are points where we blow the recitation of the Quran that the person will collapse and the jinn will speak. So this is after having checked the person for cannabis, for drugs, for alcohol, for psychological issues, for other issues, and then the person should be brought to the practitioner. The real practitioner will only use Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those methods which have been mentioned by the ulama in their books in a very explicit manner, not vague methodology. Then the jinn will speak. When the jinn will speak on the tongue of the person, so the person will speak, the tongue of the person will speak, but it will be the jinn. The jinn, in some cases, may not speak. Now there are methods of making the jinn speak. Some methods include striking the feet, because this hurts the jinn. But you don't strike the feet hard, you tap the feet. Now, this is where false practitioners have misused the sunnah. The sunnah mentions in the sunnah of Abu Dawud and others that a child was brought to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam tapped him on his back. Remember, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam never hit a child or a woman or a man except in battle throughout his life. This is why it is prohibited to hit children, especially on the head and face and on the back of the head. The ulama that mentioned that you must hit children to discipline them in order that they pray salah, this hitting has a particular description. What that means is if someone were to hold a book under the armpit and raise his hand and hit the child on the, tap the child on the back, this is only done to discipline. This is only done to discipline. So this, that would not even hurt a child. It is only done to discipline, and that is only when the child is above the age of 10 and when he refuses to pray. So this is a false practice which some of the teachers in the masajid, in the mosques do, hitting the child with sticks and hitting the child on the face. They are committing the haram and they will be punished for this. This is haram to hit children. Anyhow, some of the false beat practitioners also took hold of this practice. They start using it to beat the victim. Now, it is a fact that the victim does not feel the pain, and the jinn feels the pain, if it is an actual case. But sometimes, the victim may not have a jinn problem. He may have a psychological issue and they beat the individual to death. Or sometimes they damage the person. And sometimes the beating may be severe and the person will be harmed. So the beating which is mentioned in the sunnah is light taps. Light taps. And in certain areas, not on the face and on the head, and in a certain manner. Now when the jinn will speak, the jinn will mention many lies, because the jinn, remember, out of 100 points, 99 of those points will be lies, one point may be true for them. The jinn may mention that such and such relative done sihr magic and placed a ta'weez. Now, the talisman that the sahib uses after making a contract with the jinn kind, he makes a contract with the leader of the jinn. After they make a contract with the leader of the jinn, in that contract, what they agree to is that the leader of the jinn will give the sahib, the practitioner, a weak jinn from his tribe. And the practitioner will use certain practices to please the leader of the jinn. Now, when this happens, that jinn then is ordered to go and possess such and such person. Now that jinn is bound to that person. How they get into that person is, if that person has not recited his protection for that day, like Al-Mu'adhidatayn, Surah Al-Nas and Surah Al-Falaq, if he has not recited his five daily prayers, and he has not recited Ayat Al-Kursi, he is unprotected, or she is unprotected. And a woman who is in her menses, she can recite Ayat Al-Kursi to protect herself as a dua, not as Quran. Now if they are left unprotected, then the jinn enters into the body and the bloodstream. Remember we mentioned the jinn is like an ether. It can enter the bloodstream of a human being and possesses the person. Now that jinn is bound to the talisman. So the practitioner must ask the jinn, where is the talisman? Now the jinn will lie and will say the talisman is in such and such place. This is why in many cases the jinn is never released from the person. The jinn is never released because the jinn is bound by the talisman. But if the practitioner who is reciting the Quran is pious, he can force the jinn out many times even without finding the talisman. This depends on the piety of the practitioner. This depends on the piety of the practitioner, like Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, rahimahullah ta'ala. The jinn would obey him. And the awliya, the pious people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they can command the jinn to leave because of their piety and because of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted them. But many times, the person is not cured. Remember, if someone is a practitioner of this, it does not mean he is a wali. Many people confuse this science, because it is a science, with tasawwuf, the science of ihsan, purifying the soul. Tasawwuf is one thing, dream interpretation, resolving black magic and jinn problems, and the signs of the end of times are another issue. The two are not related. A person can be a scholar of dream interpretation, he can be a scholar of exercising jinns out of people, and he can be a scholar of the signs of the end of times. But yet, he may not be a scholar of tasawwuf, ihsan, or a Sufi, a real Sufi. In the same way, you can have a person who is a very pious individual, a Sufi, but he is ignorant of exercising jinns. He is ignorant of dream interpretation, and he is ignorant of the signs of the end of times. Many people mix the two. The two things are different. Some people even mix up medicine with tasawwuf. These are four different sciences. So it does not mean every individual who is practicing this science is a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, in some cases, the person has been made to drink the ta'weez, the talisman. In such a case, the effects are inside. And from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to give the person surut. Surut is
an Indian wood, aloe wood, which is burnt and sometimes consumed. There are other things which are consumed and given to the person. When they consume them, they will vomit out the effects of the talisman. This is from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Other methodology is that the practitioner will recite Quran over olive oil or water and spray the water on the person or rub the olive oil on the person. These are valid practices. But of course, the olive oil is applied by the person himself. The peer does not apply the olive oil on an individual's aura. For the aura of the man is from the knees to the navel. So the peer can apply the olive oil on the back of a man, but not on the back of a woman. He cannot touch the woman. In fact, women, when they go to these practitioners, must go with a mahram. Let me tell you why. We know of a mahram meaning a male relative who they cannot marry, or they should go with their husband. Shaytan, when a woman leaves the home, shaytan sits on two places of a woman. One is the head and one is the backside. And when the woman is going out to these practitioners, she is going with a shaytan, a jinn. And she's going without a mahram, a male relative. Her problem will increase. Her problem will increase. It won't decrease. The problem will increase because she is meeting a ghair mahram, a person who is not related to her. And shaytan will take advantage of this, and because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not placed protection in this, the problem can become chronic. Now, some practitioners, I have witnessed a clean-shaven individual, he carries a tasbih, a rosary bead, and he recites on every woman. And he claims each woman is receiving a share of cure. Now, how does this individual get time to recite the Quran on each individual woman? And then he is looking at the women who are not related to him. He is looking at women who are not related to him. Now, for him to recite over them, this must be done in the presence of a male relative. Because his reciting over them is like the woman going to visit a doctor. But it must be done in the presence of a male relative. This is why many women go to see these practitioners without the permission of their husband and without the permission of their male relatives. They do not tell their family. And they go out and they visit these practitioners. And the practitioners take advantage of them in many ways. And they give them money in some cases. And in some cases, they become under the psychological mind control of those cult leaders. So we must be careful of these type of practices. Whenever any practitioner you go to, you must weigh that practice in accordance with the Sharia. And if that practitioner, no matter what the reputation is, if he tells you to do something that goes against the Sharia, and we are Ahnaf, we follow the school of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, if it goes against the fiqh, the jurisprudence of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, then we must not carry out that practice. Like them telling you to go to a graveyard to bury something. This is not from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is an innovation. You should be careful of that practice. It does not matter who it is. Now, if you fear that you are ignorant and you cannot challenge such a person by saying no, then stay silent and leave. But referring to me, any such being, I will show you, he is ignorant of the Quran and the Sunnah. Any such being, they are ignorant of the Quran and the Sunnah and ignorant of the schools of jurisprudence. Now, this subject, as we know, is very deep, and we can continue talking about this subject. The idea of today was to give you a summary. This is a summary of the subject, so you have a good picture
of what the actual issue is. Imam Abdullah Khan rahimahullah ta'ala has guidelines how to choose a guide, a murshid. In his Fatawa, Fatawa Afriqiyya, on page 138, they asked Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahmahullah ta'ala regarding the saying that if a person does not have a murshid, a peer, a guide, his guide is shaitan. And they asked him, some of these people who recruit for different orders, pseudo-Sufi orders, they use this a lot. And they also use another point that whoever does not have a guide, his guide is shaitan, and someone cannot be from Ahlul Sunnah to Jama'ah unless he has a guide. Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahmatullah ta'ala replies to this, and the fatwa is from page 138, all the way to So this fatwa is over 20 pages long. And inshallah, in the coming weeks, I will translate the fatwa and it will be online inshallah. For everyone to read and research this issue. But one thing I wanted to point out regarding this, what Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahimahullah ta'ala states regarding a Sunni Muslim. He states regarding a Sunni Muslim, a person who has the correct belief, that a Sunni Muslim can never be the murid of shaitan. A Sunni Muslim can never be the murid of shaitan. So if someone has not given allegiance to a peer, and he has the correct belief, you cannot say to him that his peer is shaitan. So many people from Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah and so-called Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah use this point to recruit people for their Sufi order. If the four conditions of a valid Sufi Shaykh is that he have correct aqidah, he have Sharia, second shaft, and he have a connected chain, and he have knowledge. He has a connected chain and knowledge. These are the four conditions. Three of these involve knowledge. Firstly, before you take a peer, you must learn your own correct aqidah so you know that your peer has the correct aqidah. That's the first thing. Secondly, you must learn your own fiqh jurisprudence before you take a peer so you know that your peer is following fiqh. Thirdly, you must have knowledge to some degree in order to determine whether this peer has knowledge or not. Before these three conditions are not fulfilled in you as a Sunni individual, do not worry about getting a peer. Some people get worried, we will go to hellfire if we do not have a peer. Firstly, this is not from Quran and Sunnah and from the Ijma. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Inna shafa'ati li ahli al-kaba'ir min ummati." My intercession is for the people of major sins from my nation. So you have the intercession of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even if you are a sinner. If you have the correct aqidah and you are a sinner, you are guaranteed the intercession of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And no living peer can guarantee you intercession, because he himself does not know whether he will die an imam or not. Any real valid shaykh will say, if I die an imam with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants me permission, then I will intercede for my students. But most of these false peers will say what? I will guarantee you intercession And they talk, like I said, arrogantly with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, do not worry if you do not have a murshid. Because everyone has a murshid am. Imam Ahmad al-Dakhan rahimahullah ta'ala mentions this. Murshid am is the ulama of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'at. That you take guidance from all the Sunni ulama. General guidance. Until you do not learn your aqidah thoroughly. You do not learn your fiqh thoroughly. And you do not have a good concept of what knowledge is. You should not worry about taking a murshid khas. A specific guide. Because you are ignorant of the basics of Islam. So many people take bay'ah now, allegiance, they have qada prayers. And their bay'ah is general bay'ah barakah. It is a bay'ah for barakah, this is halal. We are not condemning that practice. But we are saying that those Sunni Muslims who do not have an oath of allegiance should not worry when these recruiters come to you and say that you must give bay'ah, oath of allegiance. No, you must learn your aqidah first. You must learn your fiqh first, jurisprudence, because even the Diobandis give bay'ah. Even the Diobandis have beers. They give oaths of allegiance. And they claim to be from the Jishti Silsila. So, having a beer is not a necessary component of being from Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Having the correct belief is a necessary component of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Unfortunately, these cults have told so many people that in order to be from Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, you need a peer and you need to give oath of allegiance. Then, surprise, surprise, the peer that they mean is their peer. So, inshallah, in the coming weeks, this fatwa will be translated and placed online. Any real Sunni will accept the fatwa of Imam Ahmad al-Dakhan if they do not accept this from me. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم واتوب إليه. Thank you.